This is video 2.1. It deals with motion. So we're over here in this segment here, forces. Key idea here is forces predict motion. So try and bear that in mind when we look at all these different things. So motion is the general starting point, and we're interested in two key ideas first, distance and time, and can we measure those, and we can calculate speed from that. If we have speed and then change in time again, so time twice, we get acceleration. So acceleration is how quickly is your speed changing. We're also going to look at some units and the difference between vectors and scalars, and also converting from imperial to metric. Now over here on the other side, we've got two key ideas, distance time graph and velocity time graph, and the gradients, so the slopes. So the slope of a distance time graph is the speed of the object, and the gradient or slope or angle of a velocity time graph is the acceleration of the object. We also have the idea of velocity, which is subtly different from speed because it includes the idea of direction. So if we combine those two ideas, we get velocity. And finally, the area under graph equals distance. But coming back to our key idea, always think about this: forces predict motion. So here we are then. We need to be able to record distance, a ruler, a stopwatch. We might do it with some light gates to make it a little bit more precise. So our key idea here is calculating speed. Speed is going to be distance divided by time. So on a little examples here, a fast car traveling for a long time is going to travel a great distance. So if we increase speed, we increase distance. If we increase time, we increase distance as well. Or we can think of it in terms of this way of looking at it. More distance for a given speed, a given time, is a higher speed. So 50 meters per second, 500 meters per second is going to be more. So we talked about conversion. We're lucky we have the Système International, but we need to know that in Britain we use miles as well, and certainly miles per hour. So this is a key thing to bear in mind. So 1.6 kilometers is a mile. And here we have Roger Bannister, who was the first person to go below 4 minutes in the mid-1950s, a very significant moment in Britain's history. So scalar versus vector. So here on the pink side of the graph, we've got some scalar quantities. Now, what does that mean? It means they only have magnitude. Direction doesn't make any sense. So for mass, if you have 4 kilograms, it doesn't make sense to say up, down, left, right. Energy similarly doesn't make any sense. If it's 12 degrees in a room, you're not tempted to say, is that left or right? It just doesn't make any sense. The vectors, on the other hand, must have a direction. So if I say apply a force, well, is it to the left or is it to the right? Which is why all of these have plus minuses. So we've got acceleration, momentum, displacement, and distance are subtly different as well. So if I go from here and I take the red route, my distance is increasing all the time, but the displacement is the straight line. It's sometimes called as the crow flies. So here we've got our two aircraft and they have the same speed. So we're trying to illustrate the second line here, both going 500 meters per second, but one is going east and one is going west. And it certainly makes a difference to them because they're more likely to collide, although I've got them not hitting each other. Okay, so here we have the distance time graph. So we've got three vehicles here, the bus, which is not moving. So as time progresses, its distance doesn't change. The yellow beetle, which does have some speed, and we can see that the line going up here, and we can see a certain gradient. But the black car is, as you can see, going faster, so its distance is increasing at a greater rate, or to put it another way, it's going faster, and that's steeper. So we have the summary here: constant velocity, faster constant velocity, and stationary again at the end. Now here, I know these slides look quite similar, but they are crucially different. So here we have the velocity time graph. So crucially now we're looking at velocity. Yeah, we are looking at velocity here. So the bus is now moving at a constant velocity, and we can see that as a flat line here. This flat line does not represent it being stationary, and you can see that here it is moving. The yellow car starts from zero, so the velocity here is zero, and increases. The black car does a similar thing, but it gains speed faster. Its acceleration is greater. So after a particular time, it will be going faster. And again, we have the summary here. So zero acceleration, here. We also have zero acceleration here, but now this flat line doesn't mean stop, it means whatever this speed here is. So we've got gentle acceleration and stronger acceleration. So again, that relates to these gradients. So key idea, gradient tells you the acceleration on a velocity. Here we've got a summary of those two ideas. So this is reflecting the same situation. Velocity here is zero, so the distance stays constant, whatever this was from the starting point. Here we've got a non-zero velocity, and that's a stronger gradient here. Faster still, stronger gradient here. And finally, we've got an increase here, which actually give you a curve on a distance time graph. So now we're looking at the area of the graph underneath the line. So here we've got 6 times 5. So we know that distance is speed times time. So we can do it mathematically here, but hopefully you can see that the area will represent that as well. If we were going 7 meters per second, it would be a bit higher and we would go a bit further. Now here we've got non-constant speed, we've got speed changing, so it's a bit trickier, but hopefully you can see it's going to be 15, it's going to be half of this, or to think of it another way, it's the average speed times, so here we've got 6 divided by 2 is the average speed, so it's 6 plus 0 divided by 2 if you want to think of it that way, still times 5. Now if the board is being really mean, they'll get you to combine these two ideas. So here we've got a rectangle here and a triangle, so we've got we're working it out in two sections here, so from 0 to 3 sections is our triangle, and then our rectangle is there, it's 2 seconds from 3 to 5, and that gives us 21. So here we've got the average speed. Now this will often be the way you actually work something out. A very constant speed in reality is quite rare, you're usually speeding up or slowing down, so this is a more realistic journey, but the average speed is still going to be accurate, total distance divided by total time. Here we've got an example of a calculation then, so remember, identify, so we're identifying our time, we're identifying our distance. Now generally we get rid of prefixes, but here it makes sense to keep the kilometers, and keep the hours and not turn. And generally in physics we turn things into seconds, but this is an exception. So usual sort of thing, formula, arrange, substitute, total unit, and we get our speed there. So now we move on to calculating acceleration, which is a bit trickier. Acceleration is velocity change or speed change divided by time taken. Now a little reminder here, distance combines with time to give us speed, and then direction gives us velocity, and then we have velocity change per second is acceleration. So acceleration is speeding up, slowing down, changing direction. So here's a worked example then. Let's say we start at 10 meters and we go up to 22. So slightly confusingly, here we've got end minus start. Yeah. So it's V is end minus the start, because most of the time we're increasing. So we're going from 10 to 22, but we want the difference. So subtraction gives us the difference. So 22 minus 10 is 12, divided by 4 is 3. So it's end minus the start. And your whole life you've heard those words the other way around, but you do just have to try and remember it, that that's what's happening in this case, end minus start. So it's the change in velocity divided by the time taken. And that gives us, in this case, 3 meters per second per second. So again, that's a tricky idea or a tricky unit, but it does make sense. It's saying every second you're gaining 3 meters per second. That's your gain in velocity for every second that passes. So here we've got some more worked examples. There's a video link to this. So again, we've got, we're identifying and we're adjusting our units if we want to. Here's our formula. Acceleration is end minus start divided by time taken. No need to rearrange. And that gives us 2.6 meters per second per second. Here we've got a slightly unusual formula. It's difficult to see exactly where it comes from, but it's arrived at by substituting in. But it is used occasionally. So again, you can pause the video and have a look at this in detail. But in essence, we can calculate an acceleration, and there's no need to know the time. S in this case, slightly confusingly, stands for distance, because it actually means displacement. So a little bit more of a complicated one, but do look at it in detail later. So finally then we've got energy linked in with this idea of motion. So the faster you're going, the more energy you have, and the formula is half mv squared. Again, you can look at this in detail, but it can be rearranged for v. So if we know the energy and we know the mass, we can work out the end velocity because of the conversion of that energy, or the equivalence of that energy to a particular speed.